All right, guys, here we go. We are back with another episode from YouTube and doing a lot of research. There's some stuff coming up right now, kind of being mainstream and talked about, and it's revolving the APA, the American Psychological Association's kind of definition around what masculinity is, traditional masculinity, and then painting this in a different light of what the original version of their message was. So the reason why I talk about this and the reason why I'm even really referencing it is because I have a lot of problems with what they're saying. And after going into the APA's, you know, journals, I'm reading through some of the PDFs that they have where they've, you know, done all these studies and talked about masculinity. There's failures. There's a lot of failures in their interpretations. And part of this is due to the fact that most of these people are dealing with scientific mindsets in which they're not actually looking at the transactional conversations and real life experiences of men. So this is done, and the studies are few and far between. This one I'm reading right now, they ended up only with about 20 papers out of first reviewing. I think it was like almost 165 or some odd, something along those lines. They can whittle it down to almost 20 papers on masculinity and studies that have been done. And a lot of these are done on very small portions. Now, this is in relation to PTSD and masculinity, which is a whole different subject. And I think it has almost, I don't really think it has any connection in my personal opinion, especially after reading this article. But there are a couple of things I want to address in here for men. And the first piece is that talking about traditional masculinity. Now, there is no such thing as traditional masculinity. That's the first flaw I see in this entire construct. And even the APA, they refer to traditional masculinity, and it's a very subjective term. Now, they refer to this guy Thomas from 2001, his book, or in his article, he writes that, you know, traditional masculinity encompasses independence, ambition, authoritative leadership, and rationality. Now, this is what he's stating. Now, very subjective. I guarantee you the studies, and I'm going to go into that actually and take a look where he got these interpretations from. But the studies are probably done on very small groups of men, not consistent with what it's actually like to be a man in society. And that is an interpretation of what it is to be a man or traditional masculinity. In the same exact article, the same exact paper right above it, it talks about how masculinity is it changes culturally, cross-culturally, and cross-time. So you can't have traditional masculinity in and of itself based on that is 100% a contradictory statement to what they're saying traditional masculinity is. Why is that? Well, the fact of the matter is traditional means that there is a substance of masculinity that is held through time that was the origination of masculinity. That's traditional, right? That's the old values, if we want to put it that way. You can't inherently have that if masculinity changes not only through culture, but through time as well, generationally. There's no version of traditional masculinity. Now, you could say the current version of masculinity was based off of the men from maybe the 80s or the 70s. If you said that, right, you'd be much more accurate. But saying traditional is a failed construct within this article, and is also a failed construct within the conversation of men. So all you guys out there that are saying traditional masculinity, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about because it's not real. That is not a true statement. Now, if you want to pinpoint a generational version of masculinity, which you've subjectively, you know, correlated to your masculinity, that is one thing. But you cannot use a paintbrush to say everything in this field is considered traditional masculinity. It's a false statement. Now, that to me is a big flaw in the conversation, both from men trying to speak about this in social media platforms and this, you know, quote unquote scientists or PhD types who are sitting here trying to write articles on it. It's a flawed construct. It's a flawed conversation. So in and of itself, the article already contradicts its narrative on traditional masculinity. And so when I talk about this, I want you guys to know there is no version of traditional masculinity. What we have handed down to us or passed along from us is a generational version of masculinity, right? The generation of the baby boomers is where we're at right now, right? That's where us who are in our, you know, 30s are looking at this saying what we were handed to as men was a version that was given to us from the baby boomer generation, of masculinity. Okay, so that's what we've been handed. It's not a traditional, it's a baby boomer version, generational version of it, right? So that's where we have this. Now, this is important because the fact when people want to talk about traditional masculinity, again, it is a subjective version of that, just like masculinity in and of itself is a subjective version of it to the person that is speaking to you, right? So it's their version of masculinity as they see it in their perception, their upbringing and experiences, and what makes a man a man. So there is no traditional value to this. And then everything that is said to you from a current value is a subjective version. So all of this ties into how we look at ourselves as men. Now, there are some things that I was reading in another article from the APA, which was talking about different ways on how we've kind of found discrepancies within, we have a discrepancy model within masculinity in which we do not align with the social constructs of masculinity. Now, while there's no traditional version of masculinity, there are social constructs and expectations, and those are derived from different versions. Now, one of the ones I really like about this, and I've talked about it before, is the normative theory by that was developed by Raewyn Connell. And the normative theory bases upon what we perceive in media. Now, the reason why I say this is because one of the things that they talk to about traditional masculinity is authoritative leadership, okay? And I don't necessarily, I can't say that that's actually true, because of the fact that you don't see it very often within the confines of actual social interaction of authoritative masculinity. That's not something that you constantly run across. Now, you see it in the business world because of the fact that leaders have to get things done. You see it in a military aspect because authoritative versions of leadership are what promote the military forward and what get things done, right? Now, whether you want to tie that to masculinity or not, because both those realms were based upon masculine constructs, you could associate it that way, but that's not what they do, right? They say traditional masculinity. So when I hear this, I think what you're referring to is the general population of men, how we interact socially with one another is authoritative. It's not. I don't see that, right? And the other thing I really didn't like was ambition. Okay, I'm not sure you can associate this with masculinity. And the reason why I say that is because I think everybody has an ambition, male or female, has an ambition for their life to be something more and be something better and have a life where they have freedom and enjoyment and comfort, right? Like there is an ambition for all of that. But I would never necessarily associate ambition with masculinity because I know plenty of men who are not ambitious, and they are men and they are not ambitious to go and take over a company or take over any form of platform or anything like this. Like they're not out there with that ambition. They have the same form of ambition that even a woman would come across, right? And I think equally both men and women have ambition. So how can you say such an ambiguous statement is strictly tied to masculinity? This is another flaw that I think is in this conversation. And this right here is also why this entire study, when they're trying to associate PTSD with masculinity, is flawed as well. Because the fact is that they're already associating versions of quote unquote traditional masculinity. They're associating those versions of masculinity with the fact that they've created the stipulation in which the studies have to meet. So the criteria in which the studies have to meet certain ideological views on that traditional masculinity, they've already filtered through this, right? They've taken those and they've said, okay, these 10 statements or 10 things that we believe traditional masculinity is, the studies that we're going to review have to have some filter through one or more of those. Okay, so now they've already created a subjective version for their evaluation of the studies, in which then it's going to paint the light in which they subjectively already view association between PTSD and masculinity. Okay, so again, very flawed review, in my opinion, on what they're trying to do. The problem is when people are talking about this, and we're talking about the PhDs, we're talking about the people who are writing these articles for the APA and everything else and trying to do these studies. When we're talking about them, these are the ones that are shaping the psychology, right? The psychology around masculinity and around men. yet they have incredibly flawed studies. They're not living in the real social constructs of society where men actually have transactions with one another. And then they're also speaking to PTSD and veterans as if they are veterans themselves, and they are not. And so when I look at this, almost everything they said about PTSD and veterans was completely wrong from my experience being around a lot of military men, being a military man myself, and being around a lot of vets and actually talking about PTSD and understanding it, right? So there's a huge flaw within all of that. But if you think of that flaw, that is the same exact flaw they're having in the conversation around masculinity. So they're talking from a point of view that has nothing to do with the actual interactions within society. They've taken minute amount of men, now created a study around, because even large studies that are done and used for scientific purposes and research tend to be less than 1,000 people. Okay, that is not a large sum of people to start creating foundations of anything on. If you look at it, we're 330 million alone within the United States. One less than 1,000 gives you no real picture. And not only that, masculinity, as they've even stated in this, and I've talked to you guys about, does not even cross correlate regionally within the United States, let alone cross-culturally around the world globally or cross-generationally. So we have a lot of flawed concepts here within this study, and I want to identify this because of the fact that if you're a guy out there and you're referencing traditional masculinity, you're just as fucked up as these guys writing the articles on it, because you're not actually taking into account that it doesn't correlate transgenerationally, okay? So remember that when you start painting broad brushes like this, you're starting to create very flawed and skewed perspectives that are subjective within that. Now, if you want to talk about your opinion, you want to talk about subjectivity as you see masculinity, perfectly fine. Do it that way, but don't start referring to it like this kind of bullshit. Because this is where the conversation gets distorted. This is where men get disoriented because of the fact that they're talking in circles. And if somebody doesn't know how to read these things, the way that they're going to perceive this is like, well, they've done the studies and this is all fact, and it's not. You have to challenge stuff like this because, number one, psychology amongst masculinity is it's relatively new. Aside from Freud, who initially started that, and then Carl Jung, who started to progress that conversation, we have not done in-depth reviews socially or psychologically specifically on men. Socially, we have started that barely in the 1970s. Psychologically, from what I can see, the majority of that only started relatively in the 1980s as a field of practice. And so when we look at this, we have to understand there is a lot of infancy within this. And not only that, but there is a lot of subjective point of views from people who aren't living that average everyday man life. So how can you talk about psychology of men when you're not in that field? You're in universities, and you're in fields of scientists, and you're in fields of upper echelon education, and you're not having the real conversation down to earth with the blue collar workers, the everyday man, the guys who actually are the vets. You're not living that lifestyle. You don't know what goes on in their heads. You're interpreting something from a very small population of them and then trying to perceive that as fact because you don't know how to even question it, right? And that, to me, is a big issue amongst the conversation. So if we're really going to have this conversation around psychology of masculinity and sociological effects of masculinity, if we're really going to have this conversation, let's be real about it and have real men talk about it. Guys who can understand this and dissect it. Guys who can actually question and challenge it and look at it and say, wow, yeah, everything you wrote about veterans is wrong, actually, because I've never had one of those conversations with my brothers. I've never had those thoughts in my head. And that's not what deters me from going to therapy, right? One of the things that this also mentions, and I'll just touch on this for a second, because again, I'm not doing a full breakdown of this article. I'm just giving some points on why I believe this kind of shit is why the conversation around masculinity is so flawed. But They talk about how, you know, men don't want to go to therapy because of the traditional concepts of masculinity, resistant to femininity, and any pieces of, you know, societal interaction that are associated with femininity, right? So that's part of their description of what traditional masculinity is. And that's why we don't want to go to therapy, because then we have to deal with emotions and all of those things. I would counter that and actually say that emotions potentially could be one of the problems, right? Guys don't really want to open up about that or even really know how to process that. And I think that's a different piece. I don't think that's causation for the resistance. One of the things they don't talk about is the fact that within society, if you go to a therapist, especially when you go to a therapist and claim PTSD, there are places that ask you about this and you cannot get a job after that. Okay. So that's a real fucking thing, right? And while you don't have to answer that, you know, that is your right. Many people will, because they don't know that they can say no, and they don't have to tell anybody about that. Many people don't know that. But the fact of the matter is that can prevent you from getting another government job down the road. That can prevent you from staying within any type of special operations or any type of paramilitary operations. So whether it's law enforcement, whether it's doing contracting for a paramilitary company, all those things can be taken away from you if you claim this. And that is a deterrent for a lot of these men, because that's where we fit in, right? When we leave the military, we fit in to things that are pseudo-military. Well, if that is ripped away from you because you claimed you had PTSD and you can't get those jobs any longer because they can start to pull information from you, maybe even Veterans Affairs documents from you, then you're fucked, right? And people don't, they're not talking about that in here. Right. So again, another flaw within the study, another flaw within the conversation. But back to masculinity, guys, traditional masculinity is not really a thing because of the fact that it inherently does not go cross generation to generation. What was manly and masculine in the 50s was not manly and masculine in the 70s, right? Those changed. And not only that, from what's manly and masculine within California is not the same of what's manly and masculine in Louisiana. Okay. Very different constructs here, guys. So we need to start painting this in a conversation where we start to say there are different versions of masculinities, which there are. Again, Raewyn Connell has written extensively on this in her book called Masculinities, but very good information in there. And if we can talk about this holistically in a way that we understand that most masculinity is very subjective and ambiguous, right? Then we can actually really have the conversation of what it means to be a man internally to us, what our values are as far as making ourselves authentic and consistent with masculinity and stop conforming to what media puts out there or what these kind of people try to perceive or shove down your throat is what they say is traditional masculinity, because that conversation ends up leading us down to a place of where we feel we have failed, right? Like we're like, oh man, yeah, I didn't even follow any of this. Now I don't even feel like a man because I didn't follow the traditional masculinity, but I kind of knew there was something there that was underlined, but this is crazy. And then you look at that and you're like, well, fuck, I don't really even associate with any of those, nor do I know a single man that does that. So why is this even traditional masculinity? Like, what are they even talking about here? Who are they even talking to here? These are the conversations we have to have, guys. So anyways, appreciate you guys for tuning in. We'll talk more about this stuff, but this is a very flawed article. And I think the APA is doing a lot of disservice to masculinity based on the fact of just reading a few of these articles recently and seeing that there's a lot of flaws in them because they don't have real men writing these. Not saying these guys aren't real men. Sure, you know, genetically or biologically they are, but they're not real everyday men. So they have an education standing, but they don't have a real life standing within actual groups of men who are doing just living as an everyday man in today's society. All right, everybody. I'll see y'all on the next one.